In this Gold Nugget segment, our featured guest is Harry S. Dent Jr. Well, Harry S. Dent Jr., editor of the free newsletter Survive and Prosper, as well as H.S. Dent Forecast, the newsletter, which offers current analysis of economic, financial, and market trends. He's also the author of several bestsellers. Welcome back, Harry S. Dent Jr.
Nice to be here, Chris.
Start off with the latest Greek drama there. Over the weekend, of course, the voters, unanimously for the most part, or at least overwhelmingly, are against much of the policies because they have to realize that the Greek banks will run out of cash quickly, and at some point there's going to have to be negotiations. How will that impact the markets?
Well, you know, it is a complex issue. The markets have been acting like, oh, Greece is no big deal, they're too small, we're prepared for it, and of course that is not proving to be the point. This is a big deal just because they're the first of many countries and sectors of the economy that are going to have to default on debt. Greece cannot pay this debt. Their demographics are horrible. They're spoiled with a long history now of socialist policies where people are just used to retiring early and not paying taxes and borrowing money cheaply through the euro and buying more than they can afford. So what I think is going to happen, at some point, they're going to have to default. And when they default, it's going to kill their credit. And it will force Greece to live within their means, because Greece would never choose to live within their means. I actually am glad they said no, because my view is the whole world, and not just Greece, the whole world is in denial over the greatest debt bubble in history. Nobody wants to admit that we all borrowed everywhere way more than we ever have in history. And nobody wants to let this debt bubble deleverage. Nobody wants to write down bad loans. Look, I mean, my view is very, very simple in a capitalist system. When banks, financial institutions, or governments make bad loans, then they lose money. They should write them down or be forced to write them down, and nobody's allowing this to happen. The only place it happened was Iceland, which went through a crisis like Greece, and this is what is going to happen to Greece if they go through the same crisis. Iceland defaulted, especially on its foreign debt, which is the smartest thing to do, you know, hurt foreigners, not your own citizens. Its currency went down because it wasn't in the euro, you know, and it had massive inflation and a big recession. Their consumers and households went through a big crisis, and then 2 years later, they were doing well because they got rid of a lot of debt. The whole point is when you have too much debt, you write the stuff down. And nobody's doing this, and Greece cannot pay this debt. But by defaulting at some point, to any degree they do, their credit is going to be destroyed. Their currency will devalue if they go off the euro. And then they will have no choice but to collect taxes, cut spending, and live within their means. They don't collect taxes. People there don't pay taxes. In Greece and in Italy, which I've been a lot, people don't pay taxes. They pay bribes.
But this is more systemic because, firstly, if you listen to what the institutional folks and the hedge fund managers are saying on some of the in the blogosphere, I find this interesting. Their concern is there's no precedent. They're saying, look, yes, Greece, fraction of the EU, a peripheral nation, it would still be like maybe losing Mississippi in the United States. There's no precedent. So there's a lot of risk that brings us back to the risk on trade that, you know, we haven't seen that since 2008, 2009. There's going to be some big adjustments that are required in the markets. And we're already seeing that with interest rates going up. And I think that should be the focus that people have to start thinking about, is that this 30-year trend, we haven't seen higher rates in some time. That's going to have a massive impact. The precedent that's $60 limit withdrawals, if you can find an ATM with any euros in them at all. The referendum, you know, this is becoming a theme as well throughout Europe. We first saw it in Scotland, and then again, I think it was in Switzerland in 2014 on the gold referendum, and now in Greece. So we're seeing some cracks in the foundation of the eurozone. Do you think the ministers have what it's going to take to hold this union together? Or ultimately, will we see sort of a fractured or regional euro?
Yeah, I've been thinking, I mean, back years, Chris, that what Europe needs is that to keep the Eurozone together, because broader, freer trade is always tends to be better, but they do probably need to split into a northern currency and a southern, a strong and a weaker one, so that the weaker southern European countries can devalue and get back into balance, you know, through a crisis, and the stronger countries, Germany, France, et cetera, have to see higher currencies, and that'll hurt their exports. But one way or the other, Europe cannot hold together in a weak world. I mean, our view, as you know, has been very simple. Governments have now for over 6 years been printing endless amount of money. Now China's saying institutions can't sell stocks, and they're propping up their stock market. They're buying unused real estate. Everybody's in denial, and you can't keep this bubble going forever. At some point, we're going to have to pay the piper. We're going to have a deleveraging of debt, and bubbles are going to burst around the world, and the China stock market is already down 31%.
You visited the nation. You flew over many of the areas there that were showing spectacular growth, but you had some concerns that they were getting ahead of their economic output. I'd like for you to talk a bit about this 30% or so, 29-30% haircut we've seen in the Shanghai index, as well as some of their other indexes, and give us an idea of whether or not you see this as something that could spread throughout the global equities markets, or was it just what the officials are claiming, and that is there was some manipulation and they're investigating it?
No. This is a big deal. The world can handle Greece going under, but it can't handle a collapse in China. And China has basically for really 30 years, but especially in the last 10 to 12 years, have been just overbuilding everything. They're not just ahead of their economy. They're ahead of it by 12 to 15 years. They've already built enough empty condos and office buildings and malls and everything else you can think of, infrastructures, for if their urbanization continued at the extreme rate it's been in the last 12 years, 250 million people moving from rural to urban areas with no skills and building stuff for nobody, even if that urbanization continued, they wouldn't need to build another condo for 10 to 15 years. So this is extreme overbuilding. It's a government-driven thing. We already saw this. Southeast Asia and South Korea had a big crisis in the late 90s because governments overbuilt their infrastructures and overexpanded. China has done twice the degree that Southeast Asia did for over twice as long. This is the biggest bubble in all of modern history, the greatest real estate bubble ever, 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 and it's going to go down like a lead balloon. Mark my words on this, in the next 5 years, and it's starting to happen.
Do you then expect for the People's Bank of China to step up their money printing to get themselves out of a potential financial quagmire, the game plan we would expect here in the United States with the U.S. Fed?
Yeah, everybody's doing that. Everybody, central banks are so into this money printing thing and overexpansion to fight the bubble that they have no other way. They have to keep doubling down. The problem is we've been saying, look, at some point, things go wrong and they lose control. And the first sign is what you said earlier in the program. Long-term interest rates from Germany to Greece, obviously, and even in the U.S. and Japan have started to trend up, despite continued aggressive quantitative easing around the world. Quantitative, you know, governments can set short-term rates at zero, which is they've done, and they've kept them there. But they can only influence long-term rates by buying their own bonds and buying government-related bonds and agency-related bonds and mortgage bonds and stuff. And that's what they're doing. But rates are going up anyway, yeah, because the markets are starting to perceive risk. And it did start with Greece. That's why Greece is important. It's not a big country. It could disappear, and then the world would hardly notice except some debt default. But what happens is the bond markets, when they start to see default, I mean, the bond markets have been in a bubble. The bond markets are acting like there's zero risk in the world, and governments won't let the economy go down. Well, Greece is going down. China's starting to go down. So the bond markets start to get on alert, and then they look, oh, who's next? Oh, the frackers in the United States. They're dead if oil prices don't go back above 70 or 80. And I've been saying that for many, many months. The frackers are dead, and they're going to default on $1 trillion in investment and $600 billion in debt over the next couple of years. Then there, you know, the Puerto Rico, who I'm down there because I'm finishing a house down there on an island there. Puerto Rico's done.
I mean, here we have Greece, obviously the model for all of European and Western society up against the ropes. And then we see Detroit, obviously the economic model for middle America and the industrial might of the United States, decimated, as you say. But I do want to talk about Puerto Rico because, you know, we just heard the governor, I believe it was less than 2 weeks ago, say, look, we can't pay our $70 billion in debt. We are bankrupt. We have no choice but to default. But you know what? There's no, as I understand it, legal recourse for this situation. It's once again an unprecedented debt quagmire. Tell us more.
Yeah, and one of the things they're having to do, they just raised their sales tax from 7% to 11%, then it's going to go up to 15% early next year, and they were rumored to be thinking about raising it to 20%. This is going to hit the everyday person there. So they are in trouble. They can't pay their debt, so they're going to have to default in some way. That's the thing. See, these small countries, Greece or Argentina or Zimbabwe or Puerto Rico, they do default historically. Greece has defaulted so many times in Argentina, you can't even count it. The U.S. can't. We're the reserve. It would be too disastrous for us to default on our treasury bonds. But these other countries can, and sectors can, like this whole fracking sector and the whole junk bond sector. So this is just going to be a chain reaction that again, once somebody defaults, like Greece, the bond markets start to wake up and say, oops, we've been assuming no risk in the world. Now we got our eyes open, and they're going to be looking for risk everywhere, and rates are probably going to continue to head up. And there will come a point, Chris, and we've been predicting this for a number of years now, where rates across the board, including sovereign bonds, including the U.S. Treasury bond, will go up, that there's a point where the safest bonds, like the U.S. 10-year or 30-year, will start to benefit from deflation and debt deleveraging around the world. But the junk bonds and the higher-risk corporate bonds will just keep going up in yields, and so will the worst countries like Greece and Portugal and Spain and Puerto Rico and et cetera. So there's going to be a real bond bath coming, and of course that's not good for stocks when bond yields go up.
We always think of that traditional correlation. Bonds go down, stocks go up, and vice versa. You're concerned that this may be a sea change event that takes both sectors down.
Yes, and again, we've been seeing a risk-off crisis altogether. Only the highest quality in the Great Depression, the last time we had a real debt deleveraging, a real serious one, the highest quality corporate bonds and the treasuries, the long-term treasuries in the U.S. actually doubled in value over that decade. But stocks crashed, real estate crashed, commodities crashed, everything else went down. And of course, junk bonds. So yeah, I see bonds going down and stocks at some point. I don't even recommend being in treasuries right now because I think they're going to go up over 3% and then 4% on the 30-year. Start to buy them. They, in 2008, the highest quality bonds and the U.S. dollar were the two safe havens when things fell apart.
Tell us a little bit about what drew a Harvard-educated, successful economist to Puerto Rico.
No, I have a property on a small island there, and it's the only real estate I still own because it's my getaway place. And I'm actually rushing to finish it to beat the sales tax price there and to have a place because I'm like, you know, I rent in Florida. I've been renting since late 2005 when we were calling for the real estate bust to happen. And it's worked very well for me to not own when prices have been, prices are still not near where they were, where I live. But this is the one thing I have because I'm like, this is a nice, low crime, safe place that if things get really nasty, which I'm starting to think with governments fighting this so far, I mean, you talk about unprecedented. I mean, the Great Depression, yeah, governments dropped interest rates to near zero and stuff, but they didn't print zillions of trillions of dollars of money. They didn't tell, you know, they actually did at one point in 1929, you know, had brokerage firms just like China just did come in and buy the market to try to stop the slide. It didn't succeed, but they tried to prop up the markets. But this quantitative easing is the craziest thing I've ever seen. It's absolute denial.
You know, we're talking about almost $5 trillion on the Fed's balance sheet.
Talking $14 trillion around the world and climbing.
If you wanted to wrap your mind around it, you wanted to succinctly put it in a nutshell for everybody. Look, it's just printing money. Okay, it's firing up the printing presses late at night, but it's to such an amazing extreme that you couldn't even set up enough presses at every Federal Reserve around the country to create this much physical wealth that they are disseminating. And of course, now that's remained contained, as you know. The corporations wind up with the funds and the larger banks, and they're just buying their own bonds and shares, but they've stopped buying their own bonds.
Speculating, and they're speculating. They're right. Everybody's playing the risk on stock markets with free money, and banks aren't lending money to businesses and consumers because, number one, we don't need it. We're already too much in debt, but they're just speculating, driving this bubble. So the key thing is that at some point this bubble will burst, and the biggest sign we see, as we said earlier, long-term rates are rising despite central banks' efforts to continue to print money, with the exception of the United States, and the China bubble, real estate, and stocks are both finally bursting, and that's my number one indicator. I care much more. I'm going to be tracking China's Shanghai Composite much more than I am Greece.
Okay, but now could this be 1998? We had the Asian contagion, as they called it at the time. It was really just a speed bump on the way to 1998, 99, 2000. You know, the NASDAQ more than doubled from those levels. It almost trebled. You know, you remember when Greenspan issued those ominous terms, irrational exuberance.
He was 4 years early. And Jesse Livermore, you know, the guy who called the 1929 crash, he was 6 months early and went bankrupt at first, shorting the market. So, yeah, bubbles are, I think China's probably done at this point, even though they're probably due for a bounce with the government propping up the market. I think even the U.S. market's due for a bounce here. I think it's oversold here. But I do not rule out that the U.S. market could make one more new high in the next month or two, especially if there's some temporary resolution to Greece here and the concern. But again, nobody, and I'm going to say this until I die, nobody can keep a bubble going forever. And that's what central banks are trying to do. They created a bubble, a debt bubble, with such super low interest rate and stimulus policies. And then it got wacky and fell apart in 2008. And ever since, they've just been trying to revive the bubble. If they keep the bubble going, then the banks don't go under. If they keep the bubble going, financial institutions don't go under, and they can make money in speculation. But while they're doing this, the everyday person keeps watching their real wages go down, and only the top 1%. And really, Chris, I did an in-depth report on this a few months ago. It's the 0.1%. One out of 1,000 households are getting most of the gains from this casino economy.
We can't say we're in a hyperinflation because we're not, but it reminds me of just a worst of world scenario. It takes stagflation and puts it on steroids because, as you say, only the upper crust is benefiting and middle America is eviscerated. And now it's a cliche just to say it. But what I find fascinating is there still are signs of runaway inflation because the everyday goods and services are costing much more, and I think that that's only accentuated by the fact that people are still earning the same wages when we adjust it for inflation, the real wages of, let's say, 10, 15, 20 years ago. As we were touching on earlier, you have traveled all over the globe. You give speeches, you give seminars, you're in high demand. And I would like for you to give some of our listeners who would like to diversify, who are thinking about properties outside of the United States, tell us some of the places that you like. You've enjoyed your trips to Australia, you've been to China, you've talked all about Europe. What is Harry S. Dent Jr.'s favorite destination?
I like Southeast Asia, Thailand in particular, Indonesia and Australia are my favorite places to go on vacation. And if I could practically live in Australia during this financial crisis, that would probably be my number one choice because it's a very civilized country. It's got low government debt. Their biggest problem is they have a huge real estate bubble. But Australia is one of six wealthy countries that actually has an echo baby boom that is larger than their baby boom. That's a rare thing. Japan has very little. Germany has none. Most of Europe has no echo boom. They're going to decline forever. But Australia's had very strong immigration. They encourage immigration, but you have to be qualified to come in. They attract high quality Asian immigrants, higher income and education than their average citizen. So they look for particular skills. I could immigrate to Australia because I have specialized skills in economics that don't exist even in that country. I could get in. But you know, they say, look, here's the skills we want. Here's the type of people we want. So you do have to qualify. You have to show that you're an asset to the country. And Canada's more like that too. And yeah, and yes, there's Chinese are going there in droves because they bring money and buy real estate. And that's what's keeping their bubble going, which is not a good thing. But the Chinese are fleeing the rich Chinese are fleeing their country, which is not a good indicator. When the smart money leaves, they know something's wrong in China, and they're getting out and they're doing it. They're laundering money through real estate. They're saying, oh, we're just going to, you know, Sydney or LA or London, you know, to get our kids into college and, you know, in a good English speaking school. And, you know, while we're here, we're going to buy a $20 million condo. And now we're not leaving the country. No, they are leaving the country, and this is how they're doing it. You put the money in real estate in a place like the U.S., and then when China blows, you just say, oh, guess what? I'm not coming back. Oh, and by the way, I got most of my money over here in real estate.
Can you deconstruct or back engineer the economic success of Northern Europe, in particular with regard to their industrial base? Because, you know, if you look at their economic model, the level of union activity, which has been completely lost here, I think, at least in Middle America, but we also see relatively high wage levels for the typical machinist and industrial base. Is there something else going on here? Savings levels, higher savings level? Because you've already noted that their demographics are abysmal.
Well, actually, Norway and Sweden are two of those six small countries that actually have eco boom that's a little larger. It's not as strong as Australia and Switzerland and Singapore, but they do have more favorable demographics. You know, no, I do have to give credit to the heritage. They have a strong work ethic and, like you say, savings ethic. They have high social, I mean, 50% of their spending is by the government. But somehow it must be fairly efficient because their per capita GDP, especially in Norway, is one of the highest in the world. That's partly because of their oil revenues. But even Sweden is higher than the U.S. on average. So there's something about their work ethic as opposed, and I hate to say it, you know, the Greeks or the Italians. I mean, I love going to those countries because they're doing socialism, but they're doing it right. And they also, one of the things they have, Chris, is they have very strong maternity benefits so that they're telling women, don't see yourself as being in conflict with having kids if you're working. We're going to support you. We want you to work and we want you to have kids. And so their birth rates are near replacement.
Any other topicality that we've missed today? I mean, there's so much going on in the markets today. My guess is you're just not terribly excited by U.S. equities.
Yeah, you know, what I'm looking for, Chris, I just had to update my book, The Demographic Cliff, for the paperback edition, and I put two scenarios on there. One is that we see, I do think we're going to see a sharper correction into late summer or fall. And I'm going to be looking at that correction. If it's only 15 or 20% at worst, and then it starts to rebound, then we may go make one more new high late this year, early next year, before we have the big crash. But I am convinced, especially in 2016, that we're going to see a difficult global stock market because the U.S. demographics get particularly weak. It's only the wealthy that are still spending strongly, and even they start going down dramatically a little bit this year, but more next year. Germany's got the worst demographics of any country in the world, and they're going to start to feel this. If it weren't for the falling euro in the last few years, boosting their exports tremendously, they'd already be in trouble. They are worse than Japan in the 90s. So I'm the big surprises in the world are going to be that the U.S. wealthy stops spending. It's going to be that the China bubble starts to burst, and Germany is going to go into a recession within the next year. And if Germany goes down, Europe is really done.
So you don't continue to expect the capital flows to redirect into the U.S. equities markets. You think that at some point those funds dry up, and if so, where do they head?
Well, you know, I mean, we're still the best house in a bad neighborhood globally compared to Japan, Europe, and China, but our demographics do get worse. And again, as the world, as people start to see risk again and stocks start to go down and real estate starts to go down in one country after the next, you know, basically a lot of this is just people making money, reinvesting money and using free money to leverage up. And at some point that game's going to be over and all these risk assets are going to go down, stocks, bonds, commodities, and the wealthy hold most of this. So my prediction is in the next 2 years, it's going to be the wealthiest people that get hit the hardest, feel it more in a downturn. But it's the wealthy that have done so well with all this quantitative easing and free money and financial assets going to the moons. When this bubble bursts, it's going to be the wealthy.
Why don't you give us an idea then as far as housing? We haven't touched on that, and this is a sector you watch closely. We do as well. Correlation between U.S. equities and housing, in particular the Philadelphia Index, housing index, for quite some time. A lot of that is tied in with the REITs and the high dividend returns. Do you expect then for this echo bubble in housing to eventually reverse course and we see another 2008, or really was 2012 the bottom for housing?
No, definitely not. One of the rules I have, Chris, that's just ironclad, that bubbles, and whether it's in real estate or stocks, bubbles not only always burst, and they've always burst in history sooner or later. When they do burst, they don't correct, they don't go down slowly, they crash, and when they crash, they go down typically to at least where the bubble started, and often a little lower. Real estate, after it has bounced in the last several years, is still not at new highs in most places, but after it's bounced, it would have to go down at least 40% to erase the bubble just back to January of 2000. That's where I say the housing bubble started, because it's just like in China in reverse today. The Chinese stock market bubbled up in the last year, 160% in a declining economy, because real estate stopped going up, started going down, and then everyday people started speculating in the stock market instead of real estate. Well, we were the opposite. We were all tech stock flippers, and then we became housing flippers. So we had this bubble from early 2000 to late 2005, early 2006, and we called that. And it has not corrected back to pre-bubble level. So I think there's a big downturn in real estate coming, and that's what hurts the economy the most, because mortgage debt is behind this, and then people get underwater, and then bank loans go bad. And but at some point, banks are going to have to write down mortgages to market value, which central banks have prevented them from doing. They're going to have to do this.
Obviously, they've collateralized a huge portion of the debt here. But, you know, there's another key component. The institutions and the hedge funds that bought up so many in large blocks of the foreclosures stemming from, let's say, 2010 to 2012. At some point, that inventory will meet our existing shadow inventory. And I'd like to know if and when you expect that to occur.
I expect housing to head down over the next 5 to 7 years again. It took that long last time. It'd be another drop even. It's not just, yeah, there's more inventory. Banks are holding back inventory. But basically, the loan mortgages that were guaranteed by Fannie Mae, Freddie Mac, and the government are semi-guaranteed. Those are the ones they've been liquidating because they don't have as much left. They're holding back tons of inventory that they don't want to take losses on, and they're hoping everything will turn out good. I've got another indicator, which is startling, which I learned from Japan, from tracking Japan. When Japan's echo boom, which is not very big, but it's substantial enough, they should have had a bounce in housing when those young people came along, just like our echo boomers are now, and started buying. But I found that a new indicator I created, there are more Japanese old people dying than young people are buying houses. The dyers are sellers. And even in the U.S., with a bigger echo boom, we're the net demand, when I take the peak buyers at age 41 and subtract the people who die on average at 79, I actually show that after 2014, last year, from 2015 forward, the net demand for housing is going to slow into 2039, even in the U.S. Not even to imagine what's going to happen in Germany and Japan with much weaker demographic. Housing, it's chapter, I think, 3 in the book. Real estate will never be the same. We've never had a smaller generation follow a larger one. The echo boom is substantial, but they still don't take us to the same heights of house buying, car buying, economic spending, and everything else in the economy that the baby boom did in the last decade. So this is a new thing, dyers versus buyers. In real estate, you have to include dyers, because real estate lasts forever. It's not like cars or candy or clothes. So real estate is just, people are going to be shocked, just like people in Japan are. And people don't realize, I have to remind people, in Japan, 24 years after their peak in real estate in 1991, their bubble burst, they're still down 60% and never had a significant bounce because of these old people are dying faster than young people are coming along and buying. So the net demand for housing has not turned up, even when the young generation comes. This is something nobody expects. And if you're a real estate developer, you need to reconsider your business strategy. And then people thinking, oh, I'm going to buy houses in foreclosure and then we're going to have another big boom again. It ain't going to happen. It's not going to happen.
I'm on board with you, but, you know, reading through a lot of the reference papers, you know, in academia, some of the more recent studies within the field indicate that the primary component in the Western world, particularly in the United States, driving the trend in home prices, which incidentally is not much more than 1% a year, higher 1%. You're not going to get rich at 1% a year, right? Income levels. And I think that's the Achilles heel that's not getting a lot of press. Without the income growth, let alone sustainable income, I mean, we're just seeing John Q. Public decimated.
And it's going to get much worse. If we go into the downturn, I see real wages are going to go down much lower. But it's still a fact that people, as they get older, they don't buy real estate. Almost all the real estate, Chris, in the family life cycle, and this is an absolute fact, is bought between age 27 and 41. That's it. You know, 14 years. And the baby boomers are way past that. The echo boomers are coming into that buying phase, but they're being offset by the increasing deaths of baby boomers. So, yes, demographically and the trends in real wages, there's no way housing, yeah, it'll probably at some point it'll go down and bounce some. But, again, Japan is already the model. Real estate went down 60%. Commercial went down 80%. And neither of those sectors has bounced 20%. 4 years later, even when the next generation is in a strong house buying trend now.
Have you carefully examined the early years following 1990s housing bubble in Tokyo, and did they have a similar bounce as we've seen over the last 5 or 6 years, what they're calling the echo bubble?
They had their bubble way before we did. Real estate bubble, a 42-year lag is the peak in spending there on real estate. It's 41 in the United States. They're about a year older than us in their peak and everything. They had a bubble right in line with their baby boom generation, peaked in 1991, exact 42-year lag on their birth index, and then demographics crashed and the real estate bubble crashed along with the economy. And their real estate fell 60%, never has bounced. But they had a big bubble. I remember, you remember in the late 80s, Japan was buying, just like the Chinese, buying real estate around the world. They had such profits from their real estate in Japan that they were using those profits to buy real estate in New York and, you know, Pebble Beach.
You'll recall that that also coincided with the Nikkei miracle. And that also, we've never eclipsed that point since then, I understand.
And never will. I'll make a prediction right here. The Nikkei will never see 39,000 in any of our lifetimes. Their demographics are so bad. And that was such a bubble. And people don't get, I keep telling people, if you want to know what's going to happen in the future, look at Japan. Japan's baby boom peaked 11 to 12 years before the U.S. and 15 to 16 years before Europe. Their bubbles burst, their demographics decline, their demographics have never been strong since, they're an aging nation, their debt keeps going up. This is what happens. And their stock markets have been down 80% at worst and are still down 50% from the top. And this is probably as high as they're going to go for a long time. So Japan is the model.
To what do you attribute that litmus test?
Their births, our births peaked in 1961. In Europe, is 1964 and later in some countries. So there's this whole chain of baby boom that have a big bubble, a big boom in their spending and stocks and everything else and real estate. And then it crashes when the demographics fall out because it was a big boom in births and a big drop. Japan's births peaked, it was a double peak just before and after World War II, 1942 and 49. So, you know, when I take that 47-year lag for their peak in spending, that gives them a double peak in late 1989 and late 1996, which was their two peaks in their stock market. And every time the demographics went down, so did their stocks. And real estate's a 42-year lag, that peaked right on the nose. So baby boomers matter, and we just don't understand that we don't get a generation this big very often. And ours was compounded by immigration on top of that. Generations like this only come along about every 250 years, and they create major booms and bubbles. And the baby boomers are done, and the last place they're still holding on a little bit is in parts of Europe. And when Europe goes down demographically, there's going to be nobody.
But are we ignoring divine intervention? I mean, the Fed and their central banking comrades, Pandora's box is open. Have we ignored the possibility of efforts on their part to continue to keep this house of cards up for a while?
Yeah, no, I mean, that is the million-dollar question, and they have done that. They've done that longer than I would have thought possible years ago, and they've done it. I mean, I would have never saw, you know, $14 trillion, and probably it's 15 by now, on central bank balance sheets around the world. It's central bankers that would just say, we're just going to print free money at whatever rate it takes. We're not going to take responsibility for the bubble we created. We're not going to let it deleverage. You can't. Japan is also a model on this, too. Japan never had a Great Depression because of endless quantitative easing, and they've been doing this since 1997 now, endless quantitative easing, and they're printing money at three times the rate that we were when we stopped last year. They're doing it more than anybody, and guess what? Their economy's gone nowhere, zero growth in the last 20 years, zero inflation. They're in a coma because you can't move forward if you don't clear out this massive debt from the past. This debt is like a huge burden, and that's on top of declining demographics, which Japan and Germany are the worst two in the world. So this is what happens when you don't face the music. And that's what I'm scared going to happen. That is another scenario, which means that we could just keep kind of like going sideways because we're not going to ever have a dynamic of recovery without deleveraging. But if they just keep doing QE and we don't have a big crisis, I think there's going to be a big crisis in the next year, regardless, and that's what's going to pop this thing. But best case, which is worst case to me, we just end up like Japan. We just don't ever really grow again, and we keep carrying this debt in the future, and the consumer levels, financial levels, government levels, business levels, and it just weighs us down, and we just have kind of like a zero long-term growth rate like Japan's had. That's the worst. I'd rather have a Great Depression like we had from 29 to 33. We eliminated massive amounts of debt. Bubbles burst everywhere. Stocks, everything. We cleared out the system.
As we wrap up here and wind up the discussion, just reviewing the blogosphere over the last few years, but particularly more recently, I find it fascinating to read these comments by people with a solid economic background who continually say, well, we obviously have a financial crisis on the horizon. It's just inevitable, but we never could return to a gold-backed currency. There's simply too much money out there. And I think it's ironic because it almost ignores the fact that the market forces may return us to some type of stable currency. There may have to be backing at some point, which would lead to a remarkable adjustment in the market value of many of these safeguards and insurance policies.
Chris, I don't know. I know we're going to have a big washout at some point, and it will. We are going to have to go back to some sort of monetary standard, and it may not be gold because there's not enough gold to back the massive global economy, but you can't. You have to have rules that countries can't just print money to push down their currency and cheat. They can't print money to cover up economic recessions and bad loans. And we've got to have some sort of standard that says, look, central banks cannot create money faster than the economy is growing. There's got to be some rule or standard. It'll only come because we have a massive failure. People are not going to admit to this until the whole economy breaks down. And there's going to come a point, I think, where the reason I think money printing is going to stop is governments, the central banks are going to lose credibility is that if after 6 years of unprecedented stimulus and money printing, we still go back into a deeper downturn, people are going to say, this can't be good, but hey, it's working good enough, and so people are going along with it. If it fails, I think people are going to say, oh, this was a huge mistake, and that's when you're going to get some real reforms.
Yeah, that's the wake-up moment. That's the aha moment when people say, we've lost complete confidence in anybody's currency because ultimately it's fiat money. It's worthless. You've been printing it by the trillions now around the world for years. It's contaminated. It will be anathema to people's way of thinking. And that's why at least a modicum of precious metals in any portfolio, even if it's just a gray swan, you want to keep it. Why don't you tell folks about some of the excellent services that you provide for our listeners who are interested?
Yeah, actually, we have a free newsletter, a daily newsletter. We've changed the name to Economy and Markets. You just go to harrydent.com and put in your email address and you're on. It's a great newsletter. It's a way of getting to know us. And then we have paid newsletters, Boom and Bust, and some other ones. And then, of course, I've got my book, The Demographic Cliff, And I would tell people in about mid-August in paperback, I would wait for that updated edition in paperback. It might only be less expensive, but you know, I made, you know, some substantial updates, so it'd be more current.
All right, we're going to look forward to having you back on Gold Seek Radio.
Okay, thank you, Chris.